What's up, warriors? This is the video number one. First video. Of course, we got the dog reaction in the house. Hey, I'm just setting up my YouTube channel, and I'm going by the name of Max Warrior. Okay, let me get the camera. It's right here. It's probably backwards. Anyways, on the YouTube, it's Max Warrior at Carnivorize. Carnivorize. Because I'm a new convert to the carnivore diet. Okay? Can you tell by my shirt? Yeah, 100% beef. So, this is the first podcast video. So, forgive my noobness. Never done this before, and it's kind of low tech, so it's on my phone, and I'm just walking around the home gym. Actually, it's three-car garage, which takes up the whole space, but I wanted to share my fitness journey and some very specific events that happened in my life that led me to this point of discovering the carnivore diet, which is crazy, really is crazy, 100% meat. Who'd have thought? So here's my big reason why. Why am I really doing this? Why do I do this channel? Why am I into fitness, health, nutrition, supplements? It really boils down to why you do things is your main motivation. So to keep this as brief as possible, because there's a lot of facts I'm trying to share in here. I've got it written on a whiteboard right here. Just the facts, man, right? Narrow it down. All right, this is hard to talk about. So please forgive me. It's hard to get started because it's painful. There's some painful events I need to discuss. So I hope you'll bear with me. I've always been athletic all my life. Sports every year I can remember in kindergarten through 10th grade. I did sports. There's at least 10 years of wrestling in there, which was my favorite. And I was very competitive. I always wanted to do better each year. I ended up going to state twice, and the highest I placed was 5th place. I was in grade school, so it was a while ago. But that's the level of competition that I was involved in. And training was, I always remember, it was strenuous. And my dad always took me to practices every night after school. So I was very competitive as a youth, and we were raised on pretty much health foods, generally speaking. We tended to eat really well. I mean, junk food was at a minimum, soda was at a minimum, but it was there as a kid. And my mom always had us on some kind of vitamin program, vitamin mineral supplements. I always remember taking a handful of pills at dinner, and that was just ingrained into us when we were kids. So I was always health conscious, athletic. Calisthenics was the main form of exercise in my youth, and a little bit of weight training, not too much, but the weights were there. I didn't really get into weight training until I was a little older. 16, high school, started lifting weights regularly, was inspired by the greatest, here, yeah. Arnold's one of my idols, and Lou Ferrigno is another one, because that's what I saw on TV. I saw The Incredible Hulk. Lou Ferrigno was just fantastic, amazing. I actually got his autograph and his picture. I don't know if you can see that. Where is it?
Oh, there it is. Okay.
Yeah, that's me and Lou Ferrigno. So always health conscious, athletic, weight training. And then what really changed my whole view on fitness and health was an incident that happened with our son. He was 2 years old. We had two kids at the time. And he started complaining of headaches. So we took him to a doctor and they gave some Tylenol and sent us back home. A couple weeks later, same thing. And he kept saying, "Mom, Dad, I've got pins in my head. I've got pins in my head. My head hurts." So we took him to another doctor, pediatrician. And that was down here in St. George, Utah, 1994. So a few years ago. And they said the same thing. They gave us some Tylenol, I don't know, a little bit stronger dose. And sent us home. Headaches got worse. We ended up in the ER a couple weeks after that. And they gave him a little bit stronger painkiller. They couldn't find anything wrong with him. And we went home and we had Christmas, New Year's, and the first week of January, I think it was January the 5th, he was 2 years old at the time, and now his headaches were so bad that he was having trouble keeping his balance, and he was having trouble walking, and he tried to walk down the hall, and you know, he was leaning to one side, and his balance was way off. And we had an appointment to see the doctor again, a different doctor. So this is like the fourth one now. And we went in there and the doctor said he needs a CAT scan or a PET scan. Can't remember. And he comes back in after he gets the results and my wife and I are sitting there in this little waiting room. And he just blurted it all out. He says, "I'm sorry to tell you this. Your son has a massive brain tumor in the back of his head. It's about the size of a small apple. And it's causing tremendous pressure on his head, which is the reason for the headaches. And it looks to me like it's cancerous. I've seen these things before. You're going to have to get emergency surgery. He's probably going to have to get chemotherapy and radiation after that." And he says, "We need to drill a hole in his head right now to relieve the pressure. And you need to get on the life flight plane, either both of you or one of you. And we're going to fly you to Salt Lake City, Primary Children's Hospital, where he will have an emergency surgery." And so if you can imagine receiving news like that, and he says he left, and my wife and I just left there completely in shock. And it was traumatic, it was tough. So we did just that. I went home and threw a bunch of clothes and stuff in a suitcase. And my wife took both of our kids. The two-year-old, Zach, was the one that was sick. And the younger one was about, I don't know, 6 or 7 months at the time. She took both of them and got on the life flight and flew up to Salt Lake City. And then I drove up there that night. So he had brain surgery and the tumors had spread all the way down his spinal cord, which are inoperable. So they said, "We can't operate on the spine, but we've seen him there, the tumor's there. He's gonna have to have chemotherapy and radiation treatments," which he did. And fortunately, he was successful. The first operation, I think it was either 12 or 13 hours. It was really long. So this thrust me right into the field of alternative medicine and health and nutrition and just everything. I thought I was healthy and had an interest in it at the time. But as soon as this diagnosis of my son, I was on a mission. Because the doctors didn't give us any other options other than the surgery, the chemo, and the radiation. And I said, well, what about alternative therapies? And he says, don't waste your time. They're not proven. Cedric said, bro, we're not interested in anything other than what we offer here. So it was up to me. I started studying. You just dive right into it. We change his diet, we use herbs, we use essential oils, we use oxygen therapy. Oh, there's just, he was taking, I don't know, probably 20 to 30 pills a day that were herbal supplements. And thank goodness he came out of everything, and the side effects of the chemo and the radiation were minimal. And he went into remission for the next 5 years. He was in remission. Unfortunately, the tumor came back again. And this was, I don't remember what year it was. 99, I think. 99 or 2000. I have to go back and look at my notes, but anyhow, the tumor came back a second time. He had a second surgery, a second round of chemotherapy. And he was good for about a year, a little less than a year. Tumor came back third time. So he had a third brain surgery. And his quality of life was starting to go downhill after the third surgery. And they didn't even get all of it on the third surgery. They got 90% of the tumor out, and there was 10% left. And they sent us home, and we used our alternative therapies. And within 2 months, a couple months later, 2-3 months, the 10% of the tumor that had been left in the brain, on the brain stems, right in the back of the head, that was disappeared, that was gone. So we're pretty excited about that. And originally, the doctors had given him a 5% chance to live to the age of 5. That was back when he was 2. So those are the odds that they gave him. Unfortunately, the tumor came back a fourth time, and he had a fourth brain surgery. And this one was successful, although his quality of life was really starting to deteriorate at that point. So my wife and I had to make the decision, what are we going to do if this tumor comes back a fifth time, which we were expecting it to happen as per the doctors. And it was less than 6 months later, the fifth one came back, and we decided that we weren't going to put him through any more treatments. We weren't going to put him through another brain surgery. So we had to decide to let nature take its course, and if it meant taking our son, then that's what we would do, and that's what we did. The last few months of his life was literally dreadful. We had him home on hospice care and a morphine drip. And what do you do besides just pray your heart out every day and night for your child? Because you have to let your child go. So on April 9th of 2002, he passed away. And that was traumatic enough. And the stress of the whole ordeal and his treatments and hospital visits and the brain surgeries and the chemo and the radiation, it was literally hell on earth. I mean, we did our best, but it was stressful. And I'm going to say right here that doctors know this. Stress is the number one killer. And stress literally wrecks your immune system. Sometimes it doesn't matter what you're doing physically, like diet, nutrition, health, supplements, remedies, drugs, chemo, whatever. Sometimes it doesn't matter. If the stress is too great, your immune system is going to be wrecked anyway. So this is what happened to me. I mean, all the stress and anxiety, lost my son. And 6 months later, I was diagnosed with colon cancer myself. So it was due to the stress and the grief mixed together on top of everything. And then I was like, wow, now I got to treat myself. So I delved into all of the remedies and nutrition and herbs and essential oils and health things that we did for our son. I was doing it for myself. And I had chemo. Let's see, my surgery was November 15th of 2002. And I did chemotherapy in March of 2003. I finished chemotherapy, no, I think I started January of 2003. I finished chemotherapy sometime in July of 2003. And August 31st, I was declared cancer-free, which was great. So I decided now I'm gonna make a transformation comeback. And I'd done a few of these before, fitness transformation contests. Let's see if you can read that. I hope it's not backwards. But it was from a company called EAS back in the early 90s. You probably remember them. I did, I think, three different transformation contests. They lasted 12 weeks. And so it's time to do another one. And I started working out, and the diet has to change too. It goes to high protein, low carbs, and at the time it was low fat. And the diet that I followed was, let's see, back then it was called the Zone, I believe. The Zone diet, Atkins, pretty much the same. But the protein focus was a priority. And for me, the protein intake that I ate was chicken, fish, eggs, and whey protein, a little bit of beef, not very much, but, you know, I was always taught, I was under the impression that beef's bad, high fat is bad, saturated fat is bad, so I tended to stay away from that. But my protein focus was always high protein, little or no carbs, and that worked. I was able to transform. Let's see, I have a picture. Let me see if I can. Here's a picture. All right, so the picture on the left here, that was the, I don't even know if that's focused, but that was the day after my surgery, and I had 7 months to that picture, 7 months workout, and I got some really good results, and I remember feeling fantastic. After that initial training time of 7 months, I went back to the standard American diet. It wasn't terrible, but I thought I was doing great stuff because I'm not eating junk food. Every once in a while, you know, I have birthday cake. I'd have candy bar here and there, but man, my main focus was still protein, whey protein. But I'd eat tons of fruit, vegetables, coming out my ears. And this is the kind of the diet that I went back to, even though I was taking lots of supplements and lots of herbs, medicinal herbs. And again, I was told by my oncologist and my doctors that high fiber vegetables are the way to go. Stay away from red meat, stay away from saturated fats. And that kind of just stuck in my mind. So I didn't know really that was the key to health. So between 04 and 2023, I was cancer free. Although I did have a lot of the mental health issues and symptoms come into play during those years, PTSD symptoms. My startle rate is off the charts. I have super sensitive hearing. The chemo messed up my taste buds and my smell. So I'm hypersensitive to chemical smells. If I'm walking down the street and I smell someone's laundry, I can smell the laundry soap and the fabric softener. It just bowls me over. It's really hard to be in public because I'm so sensitive to the perfumes, the colognes, deodorants, hairspray, shampoo. Anything chemical that people wear for fragrances is extremely difficult to be around. For the first couple of years, I couldn't even go anywhere without extreme difficulty. I had to wear a mask in public. So I was wearing masks over my face back in the early 2000s. And it's difficult. I still have that. Not as bad. So fast forward to 2023. I'm cancer-free for 21 years. I'm thinking, wow, this is great. I didn't think I'd ever get cancer again. So at the beginning of 2023, I start having these extreme abdominal symptoms. Cramps, bloating, indigestion, gas, pain in the abdomen. And it always happened whenever I ate a meal, especially if I ate meat, it was worse. So I did a lot of intermittent fasting. Whenever I would fast, I felt way better, but it made me extremely weak and tired. So it was hard to fast, but sometimes I do 2-day fasts. Every week, I would be fasting at least 1 or 2 days in the week because it was such a relief to fast, and it was very relieving. The symptoms started getting worse, and again, this is stress. This is stress related. I had some clients that come in here, and we do fitness training, and I taught fitness training classes, and have some clients online that I help with fitness consulting, nutrition consulting. So my energy level, even for the last 20 years, I have some really good days, and then I had some really, really rotten days where I just couldn't do anything. Just so tired, so fatigued. Anyways, these abdominal symptoms kept getting worse, and the pain kept getting worse. And I'm taking all my herbs, I'm taking all my vitamin, mineral supplements, and colon cleanses. Oh my goodness, I think I did eight or ten colon parasite cleanses. And this was over the course of the beginning of this year. And nothing fazed the pain in the abdominal. I kept thinking, no, it can't be back. It's not back. I was really in denial, and I was supposed to go get a colonoscopy, and I kept putting it off. I was like, no, no, it's not back. It can't, this just can't be. I know I can fix it. I can fix it myself. So I kept fasting more, because every time I fasted, I felt really good. So that was one of my main modalities that I used was the fasting. Part of the grief and stress that my wife and I went through is still lingering. I mean, on the day we lost our son, he died on a Tuesday. And my wife was about 9 months pregnant with our fourth son. So Wednesday, we got on a plane and we flew from California. So I was in the Army. I was full-time military at the time. So we flew back to Salt Lake City for the funeral on Wednesday. On the plane, my wife goes into labor, starts having labor pains. And we went straight from the airport to the hospital. And early the next morning, our fourth child was born. So we lost one, and we got one. All in the same week. The next day was Friday, and my wife was carrying the newborn baby at the funeral of our oldest. So that was the week we had. I mean, how do you get over that? I mean, how do you process that? I still haven't processed all of it, but it's an ongoing process.
Calling all warriors! Do you want to become the greatest version of yourself in the new year? Do you want to crush all of your goals? Do you want to destroy procrastination? Destroy cravings for carbs, sugar, and caffeine? Destroy your competition? Yes! You need the Brain Box by Natural Stacks. The Brain Box targets the energy centers of the brain with amino acids, not stimulants. Go tribal! Get the Brain Box for more mental drive, massive motivation, superhuman strength, mind power, laser focus, and epic energy more than you've ever had in your entire life. Don't just do it, conquer it! Get the coupon code MAXIMUS15. Link in description.
Anyways, my symptoms are getting worse. June of this year, I was sitting on the couch and the pain was so excruciating. I couldn't even get up. I was in so much pain. Abdomen was hurting. I was like, oh man, something's going on. So I went to the ER and they ran a bunch of tests. They gave me something for pain. And they came back and said, you have diverticulitis, which is it's inflammation of the large intestine. That's, well, my first cancer was in the large intestine, a transverse colon. That's what they diagnosed me with. He says, you need to follow up with your doctor for a colonoscopy as soon as possible. So like, okay. And I was like, no, this can't be back. So I went in for the colonoscopy. This was end of June this year. And you have to prep the bowel, right, for the colonoscopy, which means you can't eat anything for 48 hours. You have to flush the whole system out. So they have to, you know, it has to be a clear view for the camera. That's always fun. So I wake up from the colonoscopy and my wife's sitting there. And doctor comes in. He says, I couldn't finish the colonoscopy because you have a large mass tumor in the sigmoid colon, which is at the very lower end. And he said, I couldn't get the, there was no, the tumor was so large, it was probably a pinky's worth of space left in there. So I couldn't finish it. And he says, you need to have surgery right away and get that taken care of. And I was already in the hospital, so they just admitted me down the hall, and I had surgery the next morning. And it came back, pathology came back and said that this was a grade 2 tumor, and they have different grades. The last one, my first tumor, it was a grade 3. So grade 3 means that the tumor has grown through its original attachment organ. So for the colon, for instance, the first tumor that I had, it grew through the wall of the tumor and had protruded outside the wall of the tumor. Okay, so that is a level 3. A level 4 would have been if the tumor had metastasized and spread to another organ, such as the liver. And it usually goes to the liver from the colon because that's the path of the blood flow. Blood flows through the colon and then it goes to the liver. So normally that's what they're concerned about. And on my first tumor, it was a grade 3. It didn't metastasize, but it had protruded the wall of the colon. So that's when they recommended chemotherapy for the first tumor I had. The second one was a grade 2, so it's a little less aggressive. They caught it in time, and this one had just attached itself to the wall of the colon. And they said that the colon wall has 3 walls, and that this tumor had penetrated the first 2 walls. So I'm literally like a millimeter or so away from being a grade 3. So anyhow, they took the tumor out, and surgery was successful. And I'm like, okay, it's time to recover. It's time to do another transformation. And again, I was still afraid to eat meat and to go high protein. I was really leery to eat meat or anything heavy because I had just had colon surgery, and it was hard to digest meat. It was. So I stayed away from meat, and I thought, okay, veggies, it's got to be it. So I stuck to my vegetable, fruit, and whey protein, and eggs. That's pretty much my main diet. No red meat, really. So I'm trying to get my energy back, right? 1 month goes by, 2 months go by. I'm taking my herbs, I'm doing my Chinese herbs like I've done before. I try to get recovered back, and they do help. However, and what I'm about to say is, I hope that you remember, if you can remember anything from this video, is this, that you can't, there's a saying in the fitness world that says, you can't out-exercise a bad diet. All right, so in other words, it doesn't matter if you want to get in shape, how much exercise you do, if your diet is not on point, you cannot out-exercise a bad diet. And in the health and nutrition world, it's the same thing. You can't out-supplement or you can't out-remedy a bad diet. So in other words, it doesn't matter how many of these little remedies you're taking, essential oils, herbs, supplements, vitamin, mineral, vitamin C, CoQ10, the whole nine. It doesn't matter if you're taking a boltload of these supplements and doing... there's all kinds of other remedies too that I did. I just don't want to really list all those. Acupuncture was one of them. Anyway, it doesn't matter how much of that stuff you're doing. If your diet is not on point, then it's pointless. I didn't realize that yet. Of course, I didn't realize that my diet really was terrible. Even though I was just totally eating clean, I wasn't eating junk. I was eating fresh fruits, vegetables. I'd even do these veggie juices because I had a juicer, and I'd often make vegetable juice. But every time I did, I just got so bloated. And just my stomach would stick out because something was going on. I wasn't digesting. I don't know. But I kept thinking, veggie juice is the way to go. So anyway, 2 months went by, 3 months went by, and this is July, August, September, and my energy is not coming back. And also, I'm craving, I've got this carb rice milk and rice. Okay, I don't really eat white potatoes, but I did not have a healthy craving. This is partially due because the surgery kills off all of your friendly bacteria, and all of your gut biome is basically destroyed. And I knew that. I knew that would happen. And I was trying to replenish it as best I could, but at the same time, I was craving just tons of carbs and fruit. That was my really bad Achilles heel right there, I believe, was fruit. I know, I thought fruit was good for you. So I had these fruit shakes, tons of fruit, strawberries, bananas, peaches. Those are the main three. And of course, I threw in a scoop of whey protein powder, just like the old days. And I got to where I was so frustrated. I was just so frustrated. I mean, I thought I was doing everything right. I've been health conscious my whole life and thought I was eating right, thought I was doing the best supplement plan, essential oils, acupuncture, even did some of that this summer. And it feels really good. Acupuncture is fantastic. You feel really great for a day, but then you got to go back. You got to keep going back. And my energy just wasn't building up. It wasn't coming back at all. So on October the 20, middle of October, I was out on my deck just trying to get as much sun as I could, trying to get as much vitamin D as I could. And I had been fasting, and I was just having this prayer. It's just like, Heavenly Father, I didn't pray like, why me? I didn't have that victim mentality. That's not what I was praying for. I was praying for an answer to, like, what in the world am I doing wrong? What do I need to change? How did I get cancer again? How can this really be happening? And it just hit me like a bolt of lightning. It really was just this calm and peace came over me. And this, I heard this voice and just says, meditate. Okay, meditation. I know how to do that. I have meditation tapes I listen to all the time. And that was something that I did not enough, evidently. So now I'm being told I need to meditate more, which I did immediately. Like, okay, I got the soundtrack. I've got it on my phone. I started listening to it. A brainwave soundtrack, you know, calms the brainwaves down, calms your mind down. So meditation, yes. And the reason I believe that I was told to do the meditation was because I wasn't able to handle the stress in my life again. And this is what wrecked my immune system. Even though I was doing so many good things for my health, it's the stress that really wrecks your system, your immune system. So I started meditating, and as I'm meditating, I'm thinking, okay, what else? What else is there? There's got to be more to it. And I was on my deck again, just out overlooking the city, just a beautiful view. And the second message came through. You're not grounded. Duh. Oh, wow. I'm not grounded. I knew about grounding. I'd practiced grounding many times before. However, it wasn't enough. So I found this really cool video, several videos actually on YouTube. I think it was called Earthing. And I watched several of those. And of course, to get grounded means that you're connected to the earth. So the earth is like a giant battery, right? You have the North Pole, South Pole. It's an electrical system. And so are we. The human brain and body is an electrical system. Your brain produces electricity. It has electrical charge, positive charge, negative charge. But when you're connected to the earth, it's like plugging into the earth. It rejuvenates you. It's an energetic feeling that you can literally, it's palpable. You can feel it. And when you're not grounded, your brain waves, the hemispheres of your brain don't communicate. You have a right hemisphere, left hemisphere. If the electrical polarities are off, then you can't communicate. And your health suffers, mental health suffers, physical health suffers. So I started walking outside in the backyard without my shoes and socks and just walking around in the rocks. And I could feel it. I literally felt it was like a jolt of energy coming into my body. I thought, wow, this is great. So I laid down on the cement. And when I laid down, you have full contact with the earth. And oh, wow, talk about it. Eye-opening experience. It's just like opened the floodgates of electricity pouring into my system now. And it was like the most profound, deep meditation that you've ever felt in your life. And if you think about how the American society has gotten away from being grounded, is they invented rubber-soled shoes in about the early 60s, mid-60s. And before that, we didn't really use rubber-soled shoes. We were connected to the earth. If you have leather shoes, they're connected to the earth. If you walk barefoot in the grass, you're connected to the earth. You're hooked up to the earth's energy. So with all the fancy shoes that started coming out in the 70s, 80s, 90s, of course, you got the Nikes, Adidas, Reebok. They're all rubber-soled shoes. But what is that doing? It's disconnecting the human from the earth. And I truly believe this is one of the reasons why the cancer rate is so high and the heart disease death rate is so high. Disease in general is so high. Even though we have all this modern medicine, basically human beings are not grounded to the earth. I mean, look, if you get in your car, it's got rubber tires. Anyways, I got grounded, okay? And I started feeling better. There's actually ways to get grounded, even if you wear rubber shoes, but that's a subject for another video. So the third thing, things come in threes, right? So the third thing was, and this was the most profound out of all of them. Okay, I was meditating a little more. I got grounded every day. And I'm sitting out on the deck again in my meditation state and out overlooking the city, enjoying this beautiful view, getting the sun. Sunshine, vitamin D, and all of a sudden I just get this, it was a deep down core yearning and a craving for beef. For beef. I was like, what? What does this mean? I'm like, really? I need to eat beef? I was just literally shocked. I couldn't even comprehend what I was feeling. It was just this impression. It's just like, you need to eat beef. So I'm like, okay. All right, let's do it. I heard about carnivore diet. My jiu-jitsu coach, thank you, Jake. He's a fantastic inspiration and example to me. He's a carnivore, and that was really the first person I think I'd ever met that's a full-on carnivore. So I knew a little bit about it, and I talked to him a little bit about it. And as a jiu-jitsu coach, he's a black belt, and this guy, he's got the most phenomenal energy I've ever seen of anybody I've ever met. I mean, he teaches, I don't know how many jiu-jitsu classes a day per week. And this guy is just like a wellspring of knowledge and energy. And I totally admire him. He's just one of my greatest friends. And love you, bro. But I was like, yeah, this guy's a carnivore. All right, let's try it. So I had this protein powder. And it's from this company that I make, that I got the shirt from. And I'd used their products for years. I'd used beef protein powder off and on, but I really didn't like the taste. And I preferred whey, because whey protein tasted way better. So anyways, I'm like, all right, let's do it. So I made a beef protein shake. And I think I had been fasting at the time that I received this impression. As soon as I drank the protein shake, within literally, it was minutes. I mean, as soon as it got into my system, I felt better. And I kept getting better and feeling better. My energy started coming back. And I was like, whoa, I've never experienced this kind of energy gain from anything. And it was intense, and it was visceral, and I felt powerful. I mean, my core energy was coming back, because it had been completely depleted and was totally gone. And it lasted for about 3-4 hours, and then I kind of crashed and went down. So I had another protein shake. Like, all right, let's do another one. So I had another one, and same thing. Boom! Just like lightning bolt, zap. I mean, it just felt like the switch was on, and my core energy was just growing and getting stronger and felt better. And I thought, whoa, there's something to this beef thing. So I started eating. Got roast beef out, made a roast. Got some steaks, had some steaks. And I was switching off between the steaks, roast, and the protein powder. And then in between, I was using some specific amino acids that were really helping too, helping with neurotransmitters, because my dopamine and choline levels, serotonin levels have always been really off. So I was using some amino acids in between the beef, and I just start feeling fantastic. I'm like this is it, this is really it. And then I realized, like, that was it. Those three things, that was the reason that I got cancer again. Hadn't been meditating enough. The stress was overwhelming. My immune system was shutting down. My electrical system was shutting down, so I wasn't grounded, and I wasn't getting any amino acids to rebuild the body and rebuild the neurotransmitters in the brain. That was the key. That was the key to everything, right there. Beef protein, who would have thought? So, that awakening day was October 24th. That was a realization. And I like, okay, we got to get some more beef. So we went to the Dixie Meats and got some grass-fed beef. And I got some liver. And because I knew in Chinese medicine, they have this principle, it's called the doctrine of similars. And what that means is that like helps like. And they have a therapy called glandular therapy. And it's really fantastic, phenomenal therapy, because what happens is, say if you have thyroid problems, if you take the thyroid gland of an animal and you eat that, it has all the specific nutrition, vitamins, minerals, enzymes, peptides, amino acids, everything that your thyroid needs, you get it from the thyroid gland of an animal. Or if you have adrenal fatigue, which a lot of us do from stress, you take the adrenal glands of the animal. Bovine is usually the one that's mostly used, which is cattle, bull. The other one is ovine or sheep. That one's commonly used. But whatever gland that they have, you take that, and it will help your condition that you have with your own glands. So I thought, I'd taken liver pills before many times, and I'd always had kind of an affinity to using liver pills, and I just hadn't replenished my last batch. So I got some more liver pills, and I jumped up another level. So one level was the beef protein. The second level was the beef liver, jumped up another level of energy. The third level was the fats, the tallow, beef tallow, which is beef kidney fat. That was bumped me up another level. So now I'm taking beef protein, the beef liver, beef heart, beef kidney, and beef testicle, beef adrenal gland. I do have pancreas. Yeah, pancreas too. So I have almost all the glands, and that just kept bumping my energy up another level, another level, another level. And I started working out again. Let's see, I have my workouts written down. I write them in a journal. But I wrote them on the board here. Let's see, I had my epiphany on October 24th. And my first workout was about a week after that, on November the 6th. I take that back. It wasn't my first workout. Post-surgery this time, I tried working out once in August, once in September, and once in October. But when I did, I had virtually no strength. And I even went back to my jiu-jitsu classes and tried that. And I was completely exhausted, completely wiped out. And then it would take me another week to 10 days to recover. And these other two workouts I had, they were, I tried lifting weights, and the same thing. It wasn't even like a 20-minute workout, but it would take me 7 to 10 days to recover from that because of the muscle soreness. So now I'm all beefed up and ready to go. So I, 11-6, November the 6th, I had my first trial run, and this was a mountain bike ride. I love mountain biking. I'll show you my bike. It's over here. It's got a flat tire at this point, but it's right there. That's this red one here, fat tire bike. Anyhow, we have trails all up and down the neighborhood here, and they go for miles and miles and miles. So I went for a trail ride, had all kinds of energy, thought it was, felt great. Felt fantastic. I think it was about an hour long. Came back, felt good. Next morning I get up, no soreness, zero. No fatigue, no ill effects, no side effects or nothing. I felt like I could go again. So I started mountain biking, and I had, that was my first workout on this November the 6th. I had a workout on the 10th, the 11th, the 14th, the 16th, the 21st, the 28th, and the 30th. All mountain bike rides. And the longest was about 2 hours and 20 minutes. And the shortest was, I think, an hour and 5 minutes. So I'm going for some distance here. The longest one, I think, was 28 miles. And it's hills. It's up and down, and it's strenuous. But, man, I was loving it. I finally got my energy back. And so I started throwing in the weight training workouts for December. So let's see, December the 2nd, 4th, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, 14th, 19th, 21st, 22nd, and 25th were a mixture of mountain bike rides and weight training sessions. So it's been phenomenal. It's been a learning experience. It's been a journey I'll never forget. I will say, when I did have a weight training session, I keep track of all my weights and reps, and I was the strongest that I had been all year in this particular exercise, which was dumbbell incline bench flies. So I don't know what percentage my strength went up, but I did way more weight for way more reps. I don't know, at least 15 to 20% stronger than when I had done that workout. Let's see, when did I do that? I think post-surgery I tried that workout. I think it was September I did that workout. So it was close to 20% stronger in post-surgery. So my strength and energy are just going through the roof. However, I am somewhat sore. Not to a painful level, but probably like a 3 on a 10 scale soreness for the next 2 or 3 days. So the soreness is still there somewhat, but it's not painful. My joint pain is like next to nothing. So essentially, when I cut out the grains, the rice, tortillas, you know, the carbs, it cuts the inflammation down to next to nothing. So I'm recovering faster. And essentially, I'm cultivating the warrior spirit. And you can see my wall back here. The weapons wall. I feel more, I don't know what you call it, tribal when I have a sword in my hand. So I actually have, there's a battle axe. I have a battle axe workout. That thing weighs 8 pounds. When you're swinging that thing around, it gets heavy. So I have a battle axe workout, and the other sword, the Leonidas sword, this one, I think it weighs 5 pounds and some change. You swinging two of those around, whew, that gets heavy too. Fantastic workout. So I'm back on top. Still have some of the mental issues. Some of the mental health issues are still there, but it seems like I'm able to handle a whole lot more stressful events in life. Everybody has the stressful events. It matters, or the stressful event itself doesn't really matter. It's how we take it. It's how we handle it. If we've got the amino acids in our system that can make the neurotransmitters that allow us to process and handle the stress, it's so much easier. It's so much more stabilizing than when we don't have the neurotransmitters. We don't have the fuel. We don't have the protein in our system. We don't have the ability to really do the things we're supposed to do as we were created to do. So this is looking like I'm almost to about an hour worth. So I'm going to cut it off, and hopefully this thing recorded. It's super cold in the gym here, so I'm trying to stay warm. Oh, I wanted to show you my gladiator helmet. Yeah, it's on my desk. I think one of the other things that helps tremendously is cultivating that inner warrior, that warrior spirit. And it's like our ancestors. I mean, the Native Americans and the Mexican Americans and the South Americans, they ate the animal, the buffalo, nose to tail. They ate everything, including the organs, the brain, and the bone marrow, the blood. They used everything. And they were warriors. There's, if you study into the anthropology, is that the word, of the warriors and the tribes, how they used to hunt and eat, they didn't stand around cultivating plants and grains. They were out there hunting. And they ate the whole animal, including the organs. And I'm just so grateful and thankful. I'm so blessed. My God has smiled down upon me and had mercy on my soul by telling me these three things that I need to do. The reasons why I got the cancer to begin with. And hopefully it'll help you too. So this is my mission. I'm on a mission to help as many people as I can overcome obstacles through mental training, physical training, fueling the mind and body with the proper nutrition, which is carnivore. When I specifically went 100% beef, that was the clincher for me. It was 100% beef and the beef organs. That's what I needed. That's what my system resonated with. And I even went back to whey protein because I had a bunch of it. And I was like, I don't need to waste all this. Because, you know, those bags of protein, 8 pounds, they're like, what, $80? They used to be anyway. They're more than that now. But I went back to whey protein one time. Oh, it felt awful. It felt terrible. So I don't know what's up with the whey protein, but I had thought for decades it was the greatest, but not so much anymore. So we're going to be doing more of these podcasts. We're going to have guests on, as many guests as I can get on here. So if you're listening to this and you're a fitness person that's had an experience with carnivore diet, hit me up and let's get you on together. Here with the podcast. All right, I'm going to wrap that up and hopefully I can get this thing uploaded to YouTube. And I want to thank all my subscribers on the channel. There's some fitness videos on there, but we're going to be totally expanding our whole content to much more. But the podcast is going to be the start of it. All right. Peace. Max Warrior out. Carnivorize. Let's do it. Don't just do it. Conquer it. We'll see you next time.